Yes, welcome everybody to the SPE Digital Coffee Break. My name is Ralf Schobert and I will guide you through this next hour. Yes, the SPE Digital Coffee Break today is another session of the ongoing SPE Pioneer Summit, which we kicked off last November and which brings up a new session every few weeks. In the Digital Coffee Break today, my colleague Matthias Fritsche will catch you up on the latest update regarding SPE standardization and technology. But before we start, we thought let's first hand over the word shortly to you. We thought it would be good if you and we could get an impression of how relevant single-pair Ethernet already is for you today. And we decided to do the whole thing in form of a short poll, so we will be able to see the results in a few moments if you want. So it would be great if you would vote briefly. And here is your question. You should see it on the screen now. So the question is, how important is SPE already today? And what are your company's plan for it? You have got four possible answers. The first answer is very relevant. We plan a design in. Second answer is very relevant, but currently no further steps. Answering option number three is relevant. We currently inform ourselves, or answer number four, not relevant, no starting point, yes. And yeah, we will give you a couple of seconds to vote before we share the results. So if you want, take your time. I see that a lot of you already have voted, but some others still vote. Okay, let's wait another moment. Okay, thank you. I think that is so. The poll is closed now. And yes, here are the results. So only 7% of you mentioned it's not relevant. So the most of you say it's relevant, but we currently just inform ourselves. But 28% of you say, yeah, relevant, we plan a design in. And yeah, I guess with this, we are absolutely in the middle of a topic of today. And I want to warmly welcome my colleague, Matthias Fritsche. Matthias, can you hear me?
Yes, I'm here and I can hear you. And thanks for your first results for your poll. And now we start also to share the presentation. Ralf, can you give me the rights? Ah.
Yeah, that there should be. Now we can see your presentation mode, so not the so we can see your presenter mode, Matthias.
Yeah,
Yes, you
it's
need.
always. I wait for the handover. This is always. Now it must be the right page. Yeah.
Right, we can see
If you
everything
work with
fine.
two monitors, it's always a challenge. 50% you share the right. Okay. Thanks for your information. And we had a similar poll last year, and we see already that it's a movement from the point I want to just inform me to to the first point that we are working on first design in. So it's interesting to see the relevance also in the market becomes more interesting. But before I start, I think some of you know me, but I will introduce myself a little bit. So my name is Matthias Fritsche, and I'm working at Harting Technology Group since longer time, was responsible for data connectors. And here I am today in a second function as the share of the single-pair Ethernet industrial partner network. And I here leading at this group a kind of our technology group. Yeah. In addition, I am also a member of several IEEE groups. So I was part of the protocol standard development since 2015. And I work also in different other standards committees, and of course also in the typical industrial Ethernet groups like ODVA, Profinet User Organization, and ETG, and so on. So that's why I have some information for you here. But before we start with the real topic, I give you also some information about our single-pair industrial partner network and what we are doing. So to see here the different points, so we want to develop the market for single pair Ethernet, create all the clarity it's needed for the standardization and something more. But in total, the total goal of all of us is together to inform the market about single pair Ethernet, developing the standards together with many partners and developing all the products and bring it to the market. And big things need many companies to working together to make this vision real. What we develop up from the beginning when we developing and set up our partner network is this, our single pair Ethernet ecosystem, where you see all the different levels of parts we need to make this vision real. So of course, the technology, then the standards around, because if you talk about technology and you want to use it with many market companies in the market in many areas, definitely need a lot of standards. Then the single components to integrate this technology in your devices. And then the next level, of course, all these different components that will communicate with single pair Ethernet. And then you can jump in this various different market segment, if only to call out some of them, transportation in railway and buses, this huge area of sensor actor networks used in machinery, automation, energy, and so on. So this is the goal, to make this ecosystem live. And for this, we found together at first 7 founding members, because our foundation is set up as a legal entity, as a eingetragener Verein in Germany. So it's a group like other organizations, also, for example, football clubs. And you see here the 7 founding members, so big companies from many areas in the market, CE and Harting, mainly well known for connectivity like Cirrose 2, TE also for sensors, a big player in the market, companies like Leoni for cables, Mu Electronics for active devices, Softing also for active devices and testing, and Word Electronics for the magnetics and something more. And now we are, since some weeks, we are 45 members, and you see there's a huge number of companies from different market areas, and all these companies together have the same rule or the same target to bring single pair Ethernet together to the market, develop this market together with open standards that everybody can use. And also here's a hint, if you want to join this powerful network, please contact us. But let's jump us into the topic. And here a first very quick starting point, what I always show at the beginning of my presentation to have a basement where we start. So as many of you know, single pair Ethernet was started from Broadcom with the development of ProtoReach. And the car industry, we know all these trends, self-driving, autonomous, and supported driving. So the car industry searched for a new network, and Ethernet is the powerful network technology we have in the world. That's why they decided also to use Ethernet in the cars, and with broader reach, only running over 2 wires, 1 pair, it was the right standard. And they started to develop the standard at IEEE, because it must be an open standard if you want to use it in a big wide area. Yeah, it's a coffee break, so let's have a short piece of coffee. Yes, I hope you have also one and enjoy it. And so this was the technology, and of course, to remind you, fast Ethernet with 100 megabit works with 2 wires, gigabit all with 4 wires, and single pair Ethernet works with 1 wire pair. So let's jump a little bit in the standards. So very often standards are not so the most of the interest, but development engineers need to take care for standards, and standards bring us together because there's a basement what everybody can open use. It's public available, and this helps us to bring this technology to the market. And I start with this picture. This is a point of view how IEEE, so the organization who develop all the Ethernet-based communication, look to single pair Ethernet and also to other protocols for Ethernet communication. they look so on it like a system, and you have to decide when you start a new protocol, in this case for single pair Ethernet, what is the maximum channel or link length, how many connectors you want to have in your channel, because these are basements and parameters you have to take in acceleration when you decide which kind of protocol, which kind of coding IEEE wants to use to set up this protocol. So this that's why always IEEE are completely system development standards. Of course, main content of the standards are the function of the semiconductors, but they look on it as a complete system. Very close, they have a relationship with other standards organization, and these are the cabling systems standards. Here we have two big groups in the world. So globally, ISO IEC developing the standards like ISO IEC 11801. I mentioned this here and I go into this point later on. And then for the North American market, also this organization for TIA. So here's a very close relationship between IEEE and the cabling system, but only if all of them, of all of the standards are adjusted and works together, we can go to the market. And if you look to the component level, of course, there must be also a definition of the cables. And here also an IEC standard is relevant, the IEC 61156 series. And for the connectors, also another standard series is the IEC 63171. And I show here our supported -6 connector at first here. Yeah. So this is a landscape, and these are the different organizations who have to work very close together to set up the landscape for the standards. And let's start here, how it looks like, how these organizations work together. So IEEE organization have a close relationship to the cabling standards. They have also a relationship to the cable and connector standards. So requesting information and getting this information also. And last but not least, that are the user groups. In this case, if we look to the industry where we are active, all these industrial Ethernet system groups like Profinet user organization, Ethernet IP, CC-Link, Industrial Ethernet, PowerLink, and much more. So this is the landscape we are have to take in consideration and where we are working. So let's start at the beginning with the IEEE protocol, because this is a basement for all this development. And this is a picture I use also very often. And it shows the standard like we have it more or less since the end of last year. So you see in this diagram, in the y-axis, the different speeds we can offer with single pair Ethernet, and here the different link lengths. And what you see here compared also to standard Ethernet, depending on the speed, the different protocols offering, you have different link lengths. And this is the first and very important difference between standard Ethernet, what we have. Most of the standards all in this diagram here are point to point standards. So you have at one side, for example, a switch, another side, a device like a camera or a sensor, like it is today with standard Ethernet point to point. And I mentioned here the first time also this poodle standard power over data line to transmit over the same pair, also the power. So we get in this point later on a little bit more in deep. In addition, and this is special for single pair Ethernet, we don't have it anymore for standard Ethernet. There's a second type of standard, the so-called point-to-multipoint or multi-drop standard, where you have, in this case, a 25-meter unshielded cable, and you can contact to this one cable at different places at the cable in minimum 8 different nodes. It means 8 different devices. Unfortunately, this standard here is not working with the power over data line standard in parallel, so this is not compatible at the moment. So this is the standards we have ready, and these standards are published, and also semiconductors and other products coming up in the market now. But this is not the end, and here's some more details. You see the link segment details, different channel lengths, how many connectors you can use for the different types of protocols and the bandwidth. This is important to know if you think about the design of your connectors and cables. But I told you this is not the end. At the IEEE, different other new projects are running. So since around 1 year, there is an additional project to enhance this multi-drop standard with with the number IEEE 802.3DA. This group is active since around 1 year and working on a standard longer reach. So instead of 25 meter, they will want to go up in minimum 50 meter. And also they want to increase the number of nodes, so at least 16 nodes. So this is a project running. And also here the challenge is they want to add remote powering. So because if you look, for example, in a smart building and you want to have a lot of sensors in your lamps, for example, or inside the room, this could be a good solution to save cabling efforts and so on. So that's why it's a running project. This project is as expected timeline to finish it. It's 2023, so it's interesting to know, but at the moment you cannot start with any development of it. In addition, if you look to higher data rates over 10 gigabit, so there is also another standards on the way, the so-called IEEE 802.3CY. And this is a standard mainly driven by the car industry as a backbone inside a car, yeah, between these different computers you will have in your cars in the future to connect this devices inside a car. So it's an automotive driven standard. This is also working since, I guess, 1.5 year around, and it's active. Yeah, as I mentioned, at the moment, this is a big disadvantage, I will say. Many customers say, yeah, it's 100 megabit, 1 gigabit single pair Ethernet, but only 15 or 40 meter, we need longer reach. And yeah, now IEEE started or make a voting last month to start a new project. And it's approved to forming a study group for this. The work is not started, but it will start. And this group will take care what we can do in enhancement for speed and reach, also for, yeah, for example, up to 1 gigabit. So this project is just very fresh. So it's the latest news from IEEE, and this will coming up later on. I guess the first standard will be ready in 2024, because it's a lot of work behind here. So to look at this, in the future, we could have such a landscape. So depending on the reach, of course, we have different speeds, but I guess we will fill the gap for 100 megabit and gigabit, and potentially could look like this, but it's just an impression and the personal meaning from my point of view. And we will have this completed, I guess, in 2024, 25, something like this. So this is just to inform you what is going on in IEEE. There is a lot of things we have ready, but they're coming so much more. So shortly to compare it, to finish the point of the protocol, single pair Ethernet, what we have today, where you can start with projects, we have protocols from 10 megabit up to 10 gigabit, the same like we have for, yeah, I want to say, multi-pair Ethernet, the standard Ethernet is a name I'm using sometimes. So when we look to the transmission length, what I have pointed out, we can go from 15 meter to 1000 meter. So for the lower speeds, it's a big advantage to reach longer reaches with 1000 meter. Standard Ethernet always has 100 meter. If you look to the powering, we have remote powering too. So this Poodle class where we look into a little bit later, and at standard Ethernet, we have power over Ethernet. Now another small disadvantage, what you can imagine, with these different protocols and the different link lengths, there are no semiconductors in the market where we have auto negotiation. What is auto negotiation meaning? If you connect your laptop to the next outlet, to the next switch, there is a communication always between your device and the switch to find out the best speed and the highest speed it's possible. So it's called auto negotiation to select the highest possible speed. This is not existing or only very limited way at the moment for single pair Ethernet. There are some file chips available for 100 megabit and gigabit, but there are no chips that can switch down from 1 gigabit up to 10 megabit. So this is also important to know. And this is the standard we have definitely for standard Ethernet, multi-pair Ethernet. Yeah, number of wires and pairs, it's clear. And the big advantage every time pointed out for SPE is less PCB space, higher packaging density, and so on. and weight reduction, of course. Okay, what we have to learn up to here, single pair Ethernet definitely is a new physical layer in the same way like you use today Wi-Fi, fiber optics, or multi-pair cables. For single pair Ethernet, you need something new. So the new semiconductors, PHY and switching chips, the new magnetics, of course. You see here the magnetics, the filtering and the transformers, what it's needed. New connectors, of course, and also new cables. If you want to have more information about these details, we have also some application notes at our website where you can look in. But a short, quick jump also to the standards for these components, what we see here. And the first one is the cable. So especially if you want to think about installation, that you need cables, you go to the next company who providing cables, and you have to know what are the standards you have to asking for. And for all the data cables, there's a family of standards with IEC 61156. And also for single pair Ethernet, they're creating new standards for the single pair Ethernet cables. And the idea behind was to have one group of standards for 1 gigabit, was of course covers also 100 megabit. And here we have two standards, 11 and the dash 12. The 11 is for fixed installation, so there are solid wires described, and for flexible installations, so we have stranded wires. The typical distance in the market for these cables will be 40 meter, but the cables are defined also in a way that longer reaches for future installations will be possible. Both of the standards are released. So yeah, I wrote here released in 2020, and this standard is ready and public available. And when later on also the 10 megabit standard comes up, and for 1000 meter, of course, you need definitely a little bit more copper. That's why this group decided also to make standards for the 10 megabit 1000 meter. And there are also two standards, again, one for fixed installation and one for flexible installation. And these are the numbers dash 13 and dash 14. So this one is on the way, the draft is assisting, they're working on it. And if this is ready, I think also the 14 for flexible installation will come. So if you want to have a cable and you want to ask your cable supplier what is the right standard, please make a reference for this and also for the cable details. So what are important to take care for your selection of the cables, we have a paper on our website. Then of course, this is the most, I will say, emotional question in the market, what is the right connector? And also here, a bunch of new connectors are on the way. And these are covered now in the standard groups IEC 63171. And this was a decision done a little bit later because to create this own standards group was done on a time when already some other standards, especially the dash 6 for the industry style and the dash 1 for the SD style, was on the way. But in the future, this will be a whole family of standards. And we see here different products. Most of them are IP20 products. So for the enterprise market, that means for building automation and data centers. So here the dash 1 from CommScope already published last year. Then the dash 2 from the companies Phoenix and Weidmüller on the way to be published this year, I think so. When the company Terra, Simon with the Terra style, so the Terra connector is already in the market, mostly used in big data centers. It's a fork chamber connector. And here also the idea was to make a special version for single pair Ethernet, but this standard is they don't finish it, they have withdrawn it. And so this project was skipped and not longer on the way. But only to complete it, I show it up here. And then it's a company from Swiss, BKS. They have also a product in the market with four chambers, and they decided to bring it also as a standard for single pair Ethernet. And then the dash 5 coming up from Weidmüller and Phoenix together with some other companies for the waterproof version, M8 version, and a version with more connectors. And this standard works together with the dash 2 and the dash. The basic standard without any dash. And when it's the standard we promoting as a association, the dash 6, we call it industry style, and also the market call it industry style, where we have in one paper all the versions from IP20 to IP67, 65 with M8 styles for small devices, M12 styles, more robust for the big cables for 1000 meter. And in addition, also a hybrid connector where we have, in addition to the data pair, one more power pair to bring power separately to the devices. So this is the overview. We come up to the connectors a little bit later. Now let's have a view to the cabling standard, because these cabling standards are important, because this describes you how to install your Ethernet network. So very famous are the standards, the ISO IEC 11801-1 for general information and -2 for office buildings, hotels, and so on. And maybe you have never heard about the standard, but you use some very important parameters of the standards. For example, if you want to buy a new patch cord in your office or at home, you use the categories, so like Cat5, Cat6, and so on. And also, you know, a patch cord typically has 10 meters, and all these details coming from the standards here. And of course, this the standards group decided also to implement single pair Ethernet on the standards. And there are also special standards where we focusing on for the industrial use case, and it's -3, so ISO IEC 11801-3, describing the installation of the infrastructure inside factory plants and production lines. And in addition, here's also the connection to the automation island. And what is the automation island? It could be a machine like your plastic molding machine, or it could be an installation of robots and so on. And for this also IEC is existing, and this is IEC 61918. And all of the standard groups or organization decide also to make an amendment for single pair Ethernet, and these documents are on the way. Yeah, this, how it looks like, if you look to the standards in detail, you see also that they describe the structure of the channels. Here, for example, the typical point-to-point channels. So you have one device, a patch cord, and different connection points, and then patch cord on the other side, another device. And as you see at the beginning, we have different lengths, and that's why, depending on the lengths, different number of connection points are allowed. So up to 1,000 megabit, so 1 gigabit fork inline connections are allowed. And if you go to the longer reach, 10 megabit standards, up to 10 inline connections are allowed. And here again, also how it looks like with the so-called point to multi-point standards, this multi-drop segment, you have also one cable, different connection points, and the stubs, so the short cables to the devices, could be in maximum 10 centimeters. So this is a cabling structure you will find in this different cabling guides. Yeah, now we come to this most emotional point in the market. What is the right connection, or what is the right interface to use it in different markets, like the enterprise market for building automation and the industrial style for the industrial market? And there was a close relationship between IEEE and also with the TRA and ISO IEC group. And at the beginning, as I mentioned, single pair Ethernet was only active for automotive, and in this case, nobody takes care really for what kind of connector should be used, because we know if you look in your car and you want to repair something, there is no standard in different car vendor products for any kind of connector. So car industry have platform standards, so it's different car vendors use different connectors. But with the 10 megabit 1000 meter, with the use cases in factory automation and smart building automation, definitely the question come up, what is the right connector? Yeah, the same we have for standard Ethernet, the standard connector is RJ45. That's why IEEE decided, we should go in contact with TIA and ISO IEC to make a selection process all together. And when specification was created, was as a minimum requirement, and independent from each other, so TIA and ISO IEC starting a selection process. And everybody who has a nice solution can take care on this selection process. And after this was finished, we have two solutions now active in the market. So at first one for this building and enterprise market, the so-called AC style specified in the ISO IEC, in the IEC 63171-1 was selected. And for the industrial use cases, yeah, this not as it's this solution portfolio for industrial automation from IP20 to waterproof connectors M8 and M12 and the hybrid defined in the IEC 63171-1 was selected. And after this selection process, it was already, I guess, 2-3 years ago. Now the different committees are on the way and bringing this selection to the standards. Yeah, and if you look a little bit in detail, we have for industrial use cases, the ISO IEC 11801-3, the amendment for SPE, and definitely there refers only with a shawl, must, as it means, must be used to the dash 6 industrial style connector, the same one for the industrial automation networks in the automation islands. There's also a reference to the dash 6 connector in this case with a should. That means also some other use cases could be possible. And this is only with mostly with the view to the process industry where we have terminal blocks. It's a little bit open. And TIA did the same in the North American market. So that's why to come to the end here for the standard points, many things are clear. So we have the IEEE standard with all these protocols. More new protocols are on the way. So as an extension on the way, we have the cabling, the cable standard itself for the rope cable. We have the connector standard published already beginning of last year. So it's active in the market. We have the ISO IEC 11801-3 for industrial where the connector is referenced. And we have on the way the IEC 61918 also with the reference to the industrial style connectors. So this is the first part from my point here regarding the standards to show you up that many things are existing. Technology needs standards to bring it to the market. And now let's have a little bit also a view to the technology itself and possible SPE applications. So as I mentioned, the standards on the way, so a lot of these components are existing. We have connectors in the market from different vendors. We have cables in the market from different vendors, magnetics, of course, and semiconductors are coming more and more during the last year. And now, if you look, for example, in the internet at LinkedIn every week, new semiconductors coming up. So that's why let's have a view to the SPE applications. And during the last year, many of our members, including Harting, did a lot of customer calls and asking for feedback. And a very, very strong market feedback was that the SPE implementation will start at the field level to bring Ethernet communication to the sensor and actuator network. And also here, a short story from my business career. So I start taking care for industrial Ethernet around 2000, 2003, and in this time it was the whole market was very enthusiastic. So Profinet was just started and other industrial Ethernet systems like EtherCAT are in the market, and at this time the big message to the market was industrial Ethernet will we go from the control level up to the sensor level. And now 20 years later, if you look really in the market, there are still a lot of sensors. Yeah, this is very simple IO sensors connected with single wiring, so discrete wiring. We have a lot of analog sensors still in the market, a huge number of bus systems, and only some special sensors are directly connected with Ethernet. So if you look to vision sensors or frequency drives where you have an Ethernet connection. And that's why definitely SPE is a missing technology to bring Ethernet communication now really up to the sensor level. But then if this is a fact, and this is a feedback we learn from many discussions, but if we look on this point, when we look to the sensors today, there's only one cable going to the sensors. So in this cable was used for getting the information. Is it analog? Is it a bus system or it's already Ethernet? And there is no additional cable connector also to bring power to this application. And that's why one cable, one interface is definitely a must. And if you think about small temperature, pressure, or distance sensors, they are very small and you need only a small interface to the sensors. So this brings us to the question, how to bring the power on it? And I guess the first answer you have in mind is power over data line. Yeah, of course, this is a nice technology. Remote powering over one wire pair. So in the same wire pair you use for the data communication, you use also for the powering. You have standards for this. This is already approved. The IEEE 802.3B2 already in the market since longer time, and some additional power classes coming up in the 802-3CG. Cable lengths in the same way we have it for the protocols from 15 to 1000 meters are possible. All these different data rates are supported. We have a lot of different power classes with different voltage levels, and the coupling between the data and the power injection can be realized capacitive or galvanic. Here's the typical principal pictures. So this is existing. But let's have a little bit more deeper view to the function of power over data line. Yeah, it works in general, you can say it works similar like PoE. But in detail, it works a little bit different. It's more, you can spell it intelligent compared to PoE. So if a power sourcing equipment puts power on the link, it works in the following way. At first, before the powering starts, the PSE, so the power sourcing equipment, sends a detection impulse to the powered device and checks if a 4-volt response will come up. So a test current of 10 milliamps, and then looks if a 4-volt voltage drop is detected on the powering device. And if this is the case, when its first communication channel was set up, the so-called serial communication classification protocol, SCCP. And why this is needed, if you look, I show you up later on very quickly, the table with the different power classes. Poodle supports different voltage levels and different voltage classes. And that's why this serial communication classification protocol is needed to select what kind of powering system should be switched on. If it's 12, 24, or 48 volt. And for this, the SCCP protocol was developed. Of course, you can skip it if you have an engineered network, for example, in your car, or you have an industrial application where up from the factory, the devices are selected and switched together. Then you can skip the serial communication protocol and put on the power directly, because then you know what kind of powering you need at the other side. In addition, there's also the function for sleep mode to save powering. During sleep mode, also this SCCP protocol is active to wake up the devices, and in this case, it's working. So if failures are detected, it goes back to beginning of this procedure. So this is important to know. Poodle works a little bit different than PoE. And here are the table selected from both of the standards with the different classes. And you see already we have 15 different power classes already. The first classes here defined in the BU standard. Yeah, some persons say these are created with the special needs for the car industry. Yeah, you see again the 12 volt car voltage level you have in your passenger cars, 24 and 48 we have in trucks and buses. And when they add some additional power classes with 24 and 55 volts, here with the focus on building and industrial automation. And if you look on this, it might be interesting for industrial automation to use the 24 volt classes for this, because we have it already in our networks. Yeah. So definitely Poodle is a perfect solution for powering sensors and small actuators. So the power here is very limited. Maximum 10 watts for 24 volt are possible. The maximum power is around 50 watt if you go to the higher voltage level. So this is a first solution to bring power and data with one cable and one connector to your device. But now keep in mind, for Poodle, definitely you need an additional Poodle controller to set up this communication between the power sourcing equipment and the power device. And with this additional Poodle controller, you need additional space and additional components on your devices. And if you have a very small, tiny device, it could be a challenge to integrate everything in your device. And that's why we in our group discussing and have another solution as an alternative way to bring the power to your device. And this is a M8 hybrid. So in this very tiny M8 connector, we have two additional power pins to bring separately from the data communication with single pair Ethernet power to your devices. And if you look to the cable diameter, you can see it also in the paper we have on your website. This cable diameter is not so much bigger compared to a pure SPE cable. And you see an M8 connector is also a very tiny connector, and you have two additional power pins, and they can cover 8 amps up to 60 volts. This gives you more freedom also for the development of the devices. You can play a little bit with higher power. It will be good also for small actuators, grippers on your robots, and bigger drives to move robots or other applications. And you get more freedom from the design point of view. Of course, it's supported point-to-point topologies, but with this interface, you can create also line topologies. So you insert the power at the beginning, bring it to one device and to another, and you can source a line of devices with this interface. And of course, if you need more power and the line is very long, so the voltage drop becomes too high, you can add at several points in your line also additional power sourcing equipment. This will be a nice solution also, what you have here with this hybrid interface. So so you see we have two options to bring the power and the data to your devices, and here a short comparison. Poodle up to 50 watt, hybrid we can go higher depending on the voltage level. We say 200 watts for 24 volts and 400 watts for 48 volts. The cable dimensions are definitely the same, more or less. Connector size is very small, M8 for both, but you have more freedom for your structure of the network. You can go with this hybrid systems in lines and tree topologies. And the big advantage also from the EMC point of view, it's the galvanic isolation between powering and data communication. It could be also your, it makes your design much easier. And another point, what we have seen for Poodle, you need special additional components like the controller and additional filter components. It's not needed for the hybrid system. And last but not least, also here, this column, you will see direct supply. If you are with single pair Ethernet inside one switch cabinet, definitely you will have a separate powering interface with terminal blocks. Or if you go to a big engine in the field, then you have also definitely always a separate cable and connector for the supply of these devices. So these are the other point we have to take in consideration in addition to the different single pair Ethernet protocols. And here a picture I want to show up at the end of my presentation. What can we do? So we have the different protocol, what I show you up. So we have the 10 base T1S with this multi-drop protocol. You can not use at T1S the Poodle system at the moment. That's why if you want to use it and have the requirement only one cable and one connector, the hybrid M8 is a solution, and when you can create such bus structures, might be interesting also if you think on a small application inside your machine where you want to have a number of sensors on one line. It's interesting. When we have the 10 base T1L, it's standard for 1000 meter. Very interesting if you want to bring data in the field to sensor networks. So one group with the advanced physical layer is using this technology with an additional power ring system. You can create big star structures up to 1000 meter. And for the higher speeds, 100 megabit, 1 gigabit, you have the choice. You can go with power over data line, or you can go with the hybrid interfaces, depending what kind of requirement you have. And to make your decision, you take in consideration the cost also for the different solutions. So for Poodle, you have a fixed cost for the additional elements for your controller and also for the magnetics you need. in this, but you don't have additional cost for cables and connectors. For the hybrid connection, you save this cost for the Poodle controller and the Poodle implementation. The connector price will be mostly the same. The M8 housing is existing. The two additional contacts is not a big effort, depending on the length. So if you're longer length, the cable have a little bit higher price compared to a standard single pair Ethernet cable, but it's also not a big amount. So for shorter reach, I guess up to 100 meter separate hybrid powering might be a nice option you should take in consideration. So at the end of the day here, my statement for the selection of the best SPE protocol, of course, you have to take care of speed and reach, but also power supply should be one point you should be taking in your consideration. So thanks so far from this point here. And at the end of my presentation, we have wants to have some more polls because we want to get some feedback from you. And Ralph, you are back. Can you help me with the polls and can show the polls we have for our persons in the webinar?
Yes, of course. The first poll comes here. You should see it and, now.
Yeah, it's time for some coffee. You have the poll active or?
Yes, so it's, I can read it.
Please read it because at the moment I don't see it.
Okay, yeah, no problem, I can do. So the question this time is, are you planning to start a concrete development project with SPE as network technology? We have again four possible answers. So the first is yes, we have a running SPE project. Second one is yes, it's next year. Third one is not yet, but we think about it. Or the fourth answer is clearly no. So take a little bit of time if you want. And after you have voted, we will share it and can have a look on the results. Okay, so I think you have stopped voting. So here are now the results. Matthias, can you see it as well? There should be a window. Okay.
I have to open the Teilnehmer Ansicht. Yeah, I see it. A little bit small.
So there are 21% who mentioned yes, we have a running SPE project yet. So that's a very interesting number, I think. 10% are saying yes, next year. 48% are saying not yet, but we think about it. And 21% says no, don't know. Matthias, this is what we also see and learn from our day-to-day business.
It's a little bit different than what I expected. So definitely it's a higher number of companies working on projects, what I expect. So during the last poll similar like this, definitely the number was much smaller. So we see with the availability of the semiconductors, the number of projects now are increasing. And it's interesting and nice to see. Yeah? It's nice market development and definitely very very positive, and I see it very optimistic for the future. Yeah. So we have a more question, a little bit similar to this.
Yeah, and I can read it again. So the question this time is, how do you estimate when SPV will become consistently relevant on the market and be used in significant industrial applications? So what do you think? Is it more that it is next year? Is it more that you see for 23, 24? Is it more in 25 or 26? Or option four, do you think it's a topic for the next 5 to 10 years? So again, take your time. You can read again the question if you want. Take a couple of moments and then same principle we will share and discuss the result in here. Okay, many thanks. I think you have stopped voting. So here are the results. So maybe let's start at the bottom this year. So 27% are thinking it's a topic for the next 5 to 10 years. 23% are thinking it's for 25, 26. Most of you, 42% thinks it's for 23, 24, and 8% think, okay, next year is a breakthrough. So don't know, Matthias, is that surprising or what do you think?
It's very realistic what I see. So if you look, for example, the market development for bus systems like Profibus, this time to have it really strongly established in the market, it takes around 15 years. Profinet and other industrial Ethernet system was already much quicker with 10 years. And if you look to the starting point of single pair Ethernet, so the first protocols was starting in 2015 already. So we have now 2020. It's quicker when standard with industrial Ethernet, but it needs years. So you cannot handle this in a very short time period. So it's not a sprint, it's always a marathon. And I see there are very realistic answers here, and definitely I support this from my point of view. There might be some application coming up in the next 2-3 years, but to have it really in an automation system or in big market relevant applications, definitely it needs time and a lot of work behind. Yeah, and that's why it's also to come to our partner network here. We founded this network to make this work together, because such big things nobody alone can do. And if you do it together, it's an open standard. Many can participate and can make this vision true. And this is how we work on this topic as Harting with all the different companies here. Okay.
Yes. So
do we have some questions also?
Yeah, definitely. So many thanks first, Matthias. It was an exciting insight. And we can measure that on the questions which came through in parallel. And so again, it's up to you. As we promised, please feel free to ask your questions. Matthias will answer them. And as I said, some have already come through. So are you ready to start, Matthias?
Yes, let's look in the questions. Yeah.
So one of the first questions was
the most surprising point of or part of the webinars. Yeah.
Yeah, right. So the first question was, what is the motivation behind the new connector? So why not simply use the established M12 connector?
Yeah, there are several reasons for it. The first is a pure technical point. Yeah, if you look, I show up the protocols and at one main parameter, the different bandwidth you need. So, and for 10 gigabit, what we will have also in some applications, there's a bandwidth of 4 gigahertz needed, and that's why all the connectors we have today, also if you look for high data rate Ethernet connectors, the M12 X-coded definitely cannot support it. Just for this point, a new development was needed. And the other point is this is the emotional point, this marketing point, or if you look to your connectors around, some of you have a laptop in front of you. If you look around this laptop, you have the RG45, you have the USB and the headphone connectors. Always a connector style is also in relationship to the function. Yeah. If you see an USB connector, you know it's for USB interfaces. If you see an RG45 connector, you know this is Ethernet. And if you see your headphone connector, you know that it's for your mic and your headphone. And that's why it's really important to have a dedicated connector family for different protocols. And that's why also a development of new SPE connectors was definitely needed and done. And nevertheless, all these connectors, they are never company standards. It must be open, available, public standards that everybody can build such connectors, that you have multiple sourcing. And of course, with this growing volume and the number of suppliers in the market, it's also a cost and economic reason to have standards for this. And this is existing in the market, yeah.
Yeah, many thanks, Matthias. Another question. So with 1 kilometer links, What safeguards should be taken to protect against transitions, so or lightning in this case?
Interesting question. So first of all, for the industrial cases and especially for this long reach cabling, although the cables are used today for Profibus TP or other field bus system are definitely shielded, and there are rules to crown the shielding at the end of the and in the beginning and also sometimes in between. This is the first and important point: good shielding, good crowning and earthing system, and this is the guarantee. In addition, of course, inside your devices you have also some protection. And sometimes in the process industry, in big chemical plants, you will have also overvoltage protection devices at several points in this line. So this is state of the art, and this will be also existing for single pair. Even at, if you look, for example, in the number or in the different companies, there's already one company very famous for overvoltage protection, the company Dehn & Söhne, and so also this point is covered and will be taken care of with products for this point later on. Yeah, but it's more or less state of the art how to install it.
Many thanks. I think that clarifies. So another question speaking about single pair Ethernet implementation in industrial sensors and actuators, how do you see it coexisting to competing with IO-Link technology?
Interesting question. Yeah. IO-Link is a very good established and growing sensor bus for sensors in an automation island up to 20 meter. The good thing with IO-Link is in addition to the analog signal, you have some digital communication with your sensors to get additional data, make setup and adjustment and so on. And if you talk about single pair Ethernet directly to the sensor, there will be a competition in the future for some areas. But nevertheless, also IO-Link organization takes care of single pair Ethernet. There is an idea to use single pair Ethernet as a physical layer to enhance the possible link lengths between the IO-Link master and the sensors. This is an ongoing project. Yes, of course, there will be a little bit overlapping and competition, but nevertheless, there will also supporting of SPE technology for IO-Link, depending on the development the IO-Link group will doing in the future. Yeah, it's difficult to find a good answer, but I hope this describes a little bit what is possible from the technical point of view. Yeah.
Okay, many thanks. There are still questions coming in. So it could be that we run a little bit out of time, but I would suggest we cover them all. And if you need to go, you can do that. And if your question was not covered here, we promise we will reach out to you afterwards today. And but stay with us if you still have the time. So then quickly, the next question is, are there already cables available which fulfill the railway standards, the standards for railway?
So far I know not public available from different vendors, but on the way. If you look to the cable design, the core of the cables with the pairs, the construction of the single wires, the twisting and the design of the shielding is always the same. Is it a cable for industrial automation standard application or for railway application? Mostly the difference is the jacket material. So for railway applications, you need cables with more smoke and fire protection. This jacket materials are existing. It's more or less a topic of production. Yeah. These cables are possible, developments are ongoing, but at the moment these cables are not ready to get it, but these cables are possible and on the roadmaps so far I know from members in our association are on the roadmaps on different vendors and will be available, because yes, railway is a interesting use case, inside trains, there are also a lot of other bus systems what could be replaced in the future with SPE. And that's why there's a need also for railway cables that will be available. It depends a little bit also on the market demand, how fast the suppliers will bring these cables, yeah, to the market. Yeah, that's not a big issue to make it.
Additional to the cabling and link layer associated difference, what about frame and package distribution of data with SPE? Is the internal logic and package management the same as before in IEEE 802.x?
Yeah, as I mentioned, single pair Ethernet is just a new physical layer. So all the other definitions coming up from IEEE 802.1 especially are definitely the same. Yeah, in the same way as you can use this physical layer for voice, for other applications, it's absolutely the same. Yeah. So all these things, so at the moment TSN, so time synchronized network, is a big issue for Ethernet communication. This functionalities are available for all these physical layers, including fiber optics, including Wi-Fi, and including copper-based multi-pair or single-pair Ethernet. So it's definitely, it's only the physical layer what it's different. All the other protocols running over this physical layer. I hope this answers the question and is the meaning of the question, yeah.
Okay, many thanks. So then we come to the final question. So is there a standard transmission rate for SPE? If not, how to handle different transmission rates of the individual devices? Are the switches able to convert the different transmission rates?
This is related, I guess, to the topic of auto negotiation. So as I pointed out, if you build up a device for one for 10 megabit, for example, you found at the market the relevant PHY elements from several vendors, but they support only 10 megabit up to 1 kilometer at least. So then this device definitely can only work with 10 megabit only. There are other PHY chips available in the market for 100 megabit and 1 gigabit. There are combination PHYs already in the market. So this device, if you integrate this PHY, of course can handle 1 gigabit and 100 megabit. But this is a small disadvantage at the moment for single pair Ethernet. There is no auto negation possible over all the speeds. And if you look to the physical point, it's also clear. Yeah, if you have different link lengths, the power you have to bring to your cable to send the signals over the different distances is different. So if you want to bring the signals over 1 kilometer, the power level must be a little bit higher compared to the 40 meter. That's why at the moment there are no PHY chips available, and I guess there are also not a development on the way to cover all speeds in one chip. That's why you have clearly to decide for your system what speed you want to reach, and with the speed also the link length is connected, and as I mentioned also you have to think about the powering. This is definitely, I will say, kind of disadvantage we have to clearly point out. And sometimes if you look at some newspapers where single pair Ethernet is a nice technology for everything, you have to look a little bit deeper when you want to start a real development project. Yeah, that's why I say the 10 megabit is a big standard, I think, for sensor actor networks. For if so, for example, you compare 10 megabit with IO-Link, for example, it's already 20 times faster than IO-Link. So it's an advantage to use 10 megabit. If you look from our point of view, if you connect your laptop, of course you want to have 100 or gigabit. But that's why 10 megabit looks a little bit very slow. But if in the sensor world, there's already a lot of data you can transmit with 10 megabit, including also some video data and so on. So if you look to my connection, I have not 10 megabit, and you see me and the voice is okay. It works. hopefully.
Many thanks. Yeah, great. I think that brings us to the end for today. Matthias, many, many thanks for this exciting insights and answers to the numerous questions. So hope it was a good coffee. So for me, it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, this is a topic. Yeah, everybody has to take care for his own coffee. We take a little bit longer than expected, but it's a good, if you have an interesting speech and many questions, of course, you'd sit a little bit longer with your coffee. And I want also to point out such discussion we have here in this 1 hour only. If you are interesting to get more information, you want to be connected with guys who are developing switches already or makes the cables, connectors, semiconductors and so on, it's a good idea to join our network. So the group is really big. There are a lot of know-how inside. You can contact us also via the page. You can find me or our colleagues also on LinkedIn. If you have questions, contact us, join the network. It's definitely worth. It's a very open discussion. Everybody can learn from each other. And it's really fun to learn and get information and bring up everything what you need to develop products for single pair Ethernet. Yeah. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, so yeah, let us know if you have deeper interest in the mentorship or whatever. If you enjoyed it, this session, be there also next time. The next webinar is definitely coming. So every couple of weeks, there will be a new session. And by the way, you can find all the previous talks, so keynotes, technical deep dives on the different subjects of the ecosystem on the platform of the SPE Pioneer Summit. So you can find there all the videos if you want to watch out for other topics. So yeah, that was it from today. Thank you very much for joining us. And yeah, then we want to stay healthy. See you next time and goodbye.
Yeah, nice Easter days. And definitely the next webinar we have in some weeks is about semiconductors and then about also what is in between the connector and the semiconductor, the magnetic design, very interesting topics if you want to develop devices. So stay healthy, nice Easter days. See you soon in our webinars. Stay in contact. Have a good time. Bye-bye and have a good coffee.